We live, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, we are live. I can stand there. Right, just put the camera a bit like that. Hope you like the fez. I'm gonna move that out of the way. Okay, so what I'm gonna do, I'm just gonna hold tight a little bit early, wait till we get a few more people, and then we can start. But thank you for joining me. If you are watching this video after it's been streamed, hello, thank you. You like the hat? Thank you very much. It's a fez. Cool. I do apologize about the bad quality of the video. I'm using a webcam, so I will endeavor to make sure, you know, I get better quality in the future. But anyway, hello to everyone. Now, first of all, what I would like to say is that my content is free. So if you do like my content, then maybe consider, you know, sending a donation. So you can either do that now. There's a little donation icon. Alternatively, in the description of this video, there is a PayPal link. And even if it's a pound, 50p, a dollar, it doesn't matter. It all helps because I'm doing this for free, guys. Okay. I'm going to put my nose ring out of the way. Thank you for the videos. Wesley Williams, James Edwards, Outdoors. Hi, everyone. Jason Nelson. Hello. Martin, Larry. Yeah, I like the hat. Yeah, it's a fez. I am a son of the desert. And anyone who understands that will get it if you like Laurel and Hardy. But welcome to the stream. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit first. Now, what I would like you to do, please, I do want your content. I do want your input because your input helps. And a video like this could possibly open people's minds. It might make them look at the charts in a new light. It might make them think differently. And also, it might make them want to go back in time and look how the charts were made many years ago. Now, the charts actually started in 1952. Okay, so a long time ago they started. The Fez is a Steely Dan song. The Fez, okay. That's Martin Lair. Thank you very much. All right, so... yeah, I'm going to wait a little bit more, just get a few more people in. But first of all, give me a shout. Where are you? All right, hold on. I've just got a message here. Bear with me a second. I've got to look at this because I need to look at this. So he's short. Okay, right. So the charts. Are the charts rigged? I think this is the great debate. Okay, got two Billboard books, 1952, 1993, top 100 chart, Martin Lurie. Now, if you think, there's 14, 15 odd people at the moment. If you think the charts are rigged, just put a thumbs up. Okay, this isn't a thumbs up for me. If you think they're actually physically rigged at the moment, put a thumbs up. And then what I will do, I'm going to give you information, all right? Now, this information is part factual and also part something that just, it's like that niggly thought in the back of your mind. Something isn't right, okay? Okay, George Butler, yeah. Jason, yes, thank you. All right, good, okay. To me, it's kind of 50-50, all right. Tommy Cooper is in the house, Chris. Bella agrees. Okay, so, all right, we're getting a general consensus that it is rigged. Now, I think it was 1983 in the United Kingdom, Gallup took over formulating the charts. Now, Gallup, if you do some research, it's a company that find out trends. And what they do is they have all different charts of everything that goes on. So what Gallup did in 1983 is they took over the charts, and the charts in the UK were based on physical sales. Now, this is really important now. This is so important, because when I say a physical sale, today you may think download, stream. Now, a download and a stream is not a physical sale. A physical sale is when you, the consumer, had to go to a shop and buy a hard copy of a track that you liked. Now, it wasn't every single shop. What they did is they chose shops in the United Kingdom. I don't mean sort of a random here and there, but there were designated shops. And those shops, then every time there was a sale of a track, that was noted. And then Gallup took that information, correlated it all together, and we had the charts based on sales. Now, before you start putting any comments or anything like that, if you can just hold your thoughts, please, until I ask you to put comments, because I would like to hear from you as well. It will be really interesting to find your ideas and your points. So that's what happened. So basically, if I liked a track that wasn't in the charts in 1984, 5, 6, 7, 1990, 1, 2, 3, I would go and buy that track. And then if I bought it from a random shop somewhere in the outback, it may not get noted. But if I did buy that track from a shop that was linked to Gallup, then my purchase would be noticed. Now, of course, it's logical then that if I bought a track that was in the charts, whether it be number 22, 3, 5, 7, 9, that would be noted as well. Now, if you do a little bit of research, what you will find is that back in the day, it was very, very rare that a track would get straight to number one. Very rare. What would happen is a track would appear in the top 100. It would get played by club DJs. Very rarely radio DJs, because radio DJs were the last ones to find out, actually. More likely, it was a club DJ who would play said track. People would hear that track in the clubs and buy that track. And then slowly, it would creep up the Gallup scale. And then, of course, radio would get hold of it. They would play it more, which meant it was more easy accessible to mainstream media via the radio. And then, of course, the more you hear it, the more people buy it, until eventually it would slowly creep up the charts. So anyone my age, slightly older or younger, will remember a track getting into, say, number 40. Once it was in the charts, that was it, because on a Sunday night, you heard the UK top 40. And you would quite possibly hear that track. If you liked it, you'd go and buy it. If it wasn't in the top 40, the general public who didn't go to a nightclub would probably never hear it. So it would be at 40, and then it would maybe creep up to 38, number 30, maybe 20, but then may dip down. On the other hand, if it gained a lot of interest, a lot of plays on the radio, and people bought more hard copies, then indeed it would go further up the charts until eventually, if it was well known, there was a lot of backing, it would get to number one. Now, the Gallup charts years ago were very, very difficult to manipulate, really difficult. And I have heard rumors, and I'm sure it's happened, where you'd have an artist who would have a track and they would want that track to get into the charts. So they'd actually pay people to buy hard copies, go to shops and buy them. And that indeed would boost sales. And of course, it would up the Gallup, just the way the Gallup sort of system worked, until eventually it would maybe get into the charts. But that's generally what happened years ago. Now what we've got is the OCC, which is short for Official Charts Company. Okay. Again, I got my notes here. Okay. So it's completely different now because the OCC is based on hard copies, downloads, and streaming. Now, the trouble is now there are very few hard copies bought, but they're streaming and loads of downloads. And I'm going to touch that subject in a bit. So, okay, so we've got Gallup. Now then, we've got something here. Okay, I'm sure you've heard of the term cartel or monopoly. I mean, the idea behind the game Monopoly is to get as much money, as many properties as you can. Now, the irony with Monopoly is indeed when you start getting more houses and hotels, you get to the tipping point where even before you've won, it's a foregone conclusion that you will indeed win. Because as soon as you've got two hotels on Mayfair and someone lands on it, they might as well give up because they have to give you so much. Now, if you think about it, and this isn't just with the charts, this is with everything in the world today. People have to be in control. There are control freaks out there. Now, if we look back to the 80s and 90s, the gaming industry for the youngsters was very, very small. But now the gaming industry has got so big, it's actually taking up a lot of the revenue from the music industry. Because the charts, really, the music and gaming industry, let's be honest, are targeted for the younger generation. Okay, I play a few games, but generally, the younger generation. So the younger generation have only got a certain amount of revenue income to spend. So back in the day, in the 80s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s, when the gaming industry hadn't really exploded then, a greater proportion of that money would be spent on the music industry. But now there is this fight between gaming and music. And you've only got to look online to some of the videos on YouTube of people playing Roblox and Minecraft. Some of these videos have got tens of millions of views, just the same as some pop artist who's got tens of millions of views. So, you know, there's a battle here. But if we look at a pie chart, you know, both industries are trying to get as much money as they can from that chart, that pie. But there's only a certain amount of money in there. Now, if we look at the music industry, which is what this is about, really, and you look at a pie, in other words, you've got a pie and you've got four people in the room, you could quite happily cut that pie into four pieces. Each person has a quarter of that pie. But that's not what the music industry is like. There may be 10, 20, 30 people in that room, but it still is split up four ways. Now, that sounds a bit bizarre, but, and again, this isn't actual true science, but three of the pieces will go to the big companies. They will take the lion's share of the money. The other quarter or less is given to everybody else because these people don't want you to have the lion's share of their money because they're already losing money from the gaming industry. Now, this brings me on to the subject of the charts at the moment. Now, again, I remember back in the day when I was a youngster, my mum and dad indeed said, all the stuff in the charts now is crap. Or, you know, not so much crap, but oh, I remember the good old days when it was rock and roll and Tamla and Northern Soul. And I suppose I'm a bit like that now. It's all crap. But it isn't. But what it is the same artists, the same sound, the same people. And if you do research, you will find that the companies behind the artists all seem to be the same. Now, if you think about it and do some research, there are quite possibly tens of thousands of tracks released every single day. Yet, how come we only hear the same artists, the same tracks in the top 40? So that's a question after this stream you need to ask yourself. It's balmy, to be quite honest. It's absolutely balmy. And I will, you know, I'll go a little bit deeper into that subject very soon. Now, again, we've got less artists in the charts. Let's have a look. Now, also, how the system is manipulated is there's actually now less physical places to buy music, buy a hard copy. You see, back in the day, you had to buy a single, a cassette, a physical album, a physical 12-inch, a physical 7-inch. You had to buy the physical copy. And if you wanted to record that, if somebody wanted to record your entire collection, let's say in the 80s and 90s, early 90s, someone wanted to record your DJ collection, it would take them weeks. So your record collection was priceless. Nowadays, I can take that thumb drive, put it in my laptop, and someone could copy that within 10 minutes. So music now is expendable. It's just thrown away. But what we've got now is, if you think about it, we have download, stream, and physical. Now, the physical copies that are bought are minuscule compared to downloading and streaming. Yet, the charts today are based on all three. Now, I would hazard a guess to say that streaming and downloading can be manufactured, can be made. Because if you are said hierarchy in a company and you desperately want your track to be number one, or your artist to stay at number one, or your artist or artists to be in the top 40, you will do anything and everything physically possible to make sure they stay there. Now, it's obvious to me, if it isn't to you yet, then wake the frig up. The system, the web, how we perceive it, how we feel we perceive it, is not how we think it is, it's how it's made for us. We have something called the Google bubble. Do some research on the Google bubble. Because whenever you log in, have you noticed now, when you log into your laptop, you type your password in, and all of a sudden, you're online. But do you realize, when you buy a new laptop, one of the first things you have to do is put your email address in. So straight away, the system knows who you are. They know you've got, well, maybe it doesn't know you've got a new email, probably does. But as soon as you then log on to the web, there you go. You're back where you started with your old laptop. So if you imagine you are the head of one of the big companies, don't you think it's in your best interest to maybe make sure that your track has a lot of downloads? Your track is streamed a lot. Now, again, we have this term clickbait. So who's to say that there aren't machines out there that are clicking a track again and again and again to get the rate of views up, to increase its exposure, in turn increase the chance of it getting into the charts, higher into the charts, and away you go. So that's one way how I am convinced the companies manipulate the system. But also, I am sure there are backhanders to the radio stations. Here we go. Here's a few million or thousand. Play this track. But also, as well, it's very psychological here. Now, let's imagine you have never heard track A before in your life, just track A. And I play it to you once. But then I play it again, and then again, and again, and again, and again. Eventually, it's going to sink in. And it's likely you're going to start to like that track. And then eventually, you'll want to hear it again. So you'll listen to it on YouTube, Vimeo, or you'll download it. Well, there you go. You have helped the industry. And this is what happens. The system's very clever. Now, in the UK, we have Radio One. Amazing. But if you listen to Radio One, and if you actually, say, listened for a period of 2 or 3 hours, they will play the same tracks over and over again. And you've only got to go online and see their A list, B and C. And guess what? The A list, it's practically every hour. The B list, every couple of hours, and so on. So by definition, the more they play a track, the more you hear it, the more you will probably indeed like it and eventually buy it. So in a way, if you follow the charts and you like what's in the charts, you need to ask yourself, do you actually physically like that music because you like it, or do you like it because you've been made to like it? And there's hell of a difference there. There is hell of a difference. Now, I've heard so many fantastic artists, as I'm sure you have, so many great producers, bands, singer-songwriters, and I'm thinking, hold on a minute, how come they're not in the charts? Simple. Because they don't have the big companies behind them, promoting them and pushing them. Now, also as well, I've heard stories of big companies, having on their books a new band, a new artist, paying the money, but never giving them the exposure, because they know if they've got hold of them, and they have a contract where they're in charge of the promotion of that said band or artist, then they're in control of how well they do. And if they don't want them to do well, then they won't let them do well because they are now in control of them. Okay, let's have a look. What have I got here? Streamed copies. Right. All right. Let's just have a look at the chat here. Give me a few thoughts. Did anyone else watch that show Vinyl about the music industry? The story was about running a major label, all tricks of the trade, good and bad. I can't say of the truth, but I wish I got more time. Versacara. No, I haven't heard of that. That sounds very interesting. Jimmy Evans, 200K subs, 30 people watching. Jimmy Evans, I can answer that very simply. This channel is a very old channel. So when people started watching me, they would watch, they'd learn how to DJ, and then move on. All right. So I don't expect to have millions of views. I've got a slow tick over, and that's how it's always been. Okay. If I'd have started this channel 6 months ago with 200,000 subscribers, then of course, there should be 2,000 or 3,000 people watching. But this is an old school channel, so it doesn't bother me. Okay. Nice hat, by the way. Thank you. And that was Versacara. Mitch Brown, I'm convinced Pete Tong takes the occasional backhander. He plays some shocking tunes in the first 15 minutes on occasion in the otherwise quality show. Well, you know, again, we will never know, okay? We won't know this. But, and I will explain how it's very likely that happens, very likely. But if you've got an artist out there in the public eye, then you get to the stage, or they get to the stage, where they don't have to buy anything. The company will give them stuff. So, for example, it's very likely that if you see this famous film star or movie star or pop star, and they've got a brand new Rolex on, and they, you know, they're like this with it, it's very likely that they've been given it, because the fact they're wearing it is enough promotion for that company, for the company to sell it. Because these sycophantic people who want to be like their superstars and their idols will do anything in their power, whatever it costs, to be like them. Now, I can guarantee that happens, because I myself, through this channel, have been given, when I say for free, I use that very lightly, because a company will not just say, "Jonathan, we love what you do. Here is a speaker. Thank you very much." They're not going to give me stuff for free. I have to pay back. So I will promote that, use it, show it off, demo it in return for having that. But you see, once people see me using something, physically using it, then they go, "Oh, that's how it works. I see it. Jonathan's got it. He's explained it's good. It's a great piece of kit. I might go and buy it." So that does work. That's how the industry does work, in a way. Okay, so let's have a look. James Edwards, "When I do a live stream, I'm lucky if I get 10 people watching." Okay. Chris Foster, "Everyone has their own charts these days. Back in the day, it was more unique, as no internet, etc. Just waiting for every Sunday to come around to get the old cassette recorder out and tape it, best tune." No, I agree. Because after the charts, we had, I think it was If It Moves, Funk It. And then there was Gary Bird and the GB Experience. Sunday nights were amazing. Everyone listened to the charts. And also Top of the Pops, I think, on a Thursday. Man, you didn't miss Top of the Pops. You just didn't miss it, okay? ADM, Carrie Fuges, NI. "I wouldn't worry watching Carl Cox the other night. He only had average of 600 viewers. If I get 10 viewers, being a nobody, I'm happy with that." Well, yeah, there you go. Okay, nice one. Space Monkey Dave, "Gaming has gone through a lot of the same sales models, physical download, and now streaming. The new big thing is subscription like Spotify, but devs are not revenue like artists are." Okay, I've missed that bit. Okay, so actually you've hit on a point there that does concern me, is, you know, we're going from, or what's happened in the music industry and also is happening now in the gaming industry. And again, this could be a little bit far-fetched, but I honestly, personally think it's the way forward, but you have to be very careful. You've got to be very careful how the system takes you. And give me a thumbs up, please, if you just agree. If you disagree, give me a thumbs down, but hear me first. Years ago, you would have to buy a cassette, a piece of vinyl, the physical copy. Now what you do is you can download the track and you can have it on your hard drive and you can listen to it. But more and more now, again with gaming, you would go and buy a physical game, a DVD, put it in your laptop, and away you went. And now you download the game and then you play it. But what's happening more now is now you can just listen to music, pay a subscription, and there it is. So you're paying to listen to music. You don't even have to download it anymore. You can just listen. And isn't that amazing? Because it means you no longer have to find your tracks. Have you deleted them? Where's the thumb drive gone? My computer's broken. I haven't got it anymore. But this is the scary bit, is in the future, if we solely rely on streaming, what happens if it stops? What happens if you do something wrong and they take that away from you. You've got nothing then. You have no physical copy. You have no way of getting it. You have nothing to back up what you did have. Therefore, you can't listen to music. Now, this does sound very far-fetched, but it's actually the way we're going. Technology is taking over. I predict in the future, there will be laptops with not even a hard drive in. It will be basically a laptop that will allow you to go on the web, and all of your information will be on the web. And you will have to be a very good boy and a very good girl. Do as you're told, because if you don't, you will be stopped from even going on the web. And we're getting there. Okay, we're getting there. I wouldn't worry. You know, Carl Cox, gaming has gone through a lot of the same sales. Yeah. Martin Leary, in the old days, there wasn't anything like going to record shop, look around it and letting be advised by the guys in the shop. I would go with my own list and the rest was their recommendations. Okay, George Butler agrees. Well, exactly. You see, you know, a lot of people may be watching this now and in the future. You have missed one of the most wonderful times in the music industry, which is physically going into a record shop and just scooting through the tracks and buying your own physical copies. You know, I mean, if I go down here, all right, I've still got, you know, I've got physical, okay? You see, now, if all of a sudden the internet went down, all right, I could get a turntable out and I could play some music, all right? But the future, the way it's moving, and it's moving in at a very fast pace, there will be people, when the internet's off, you're buggered. You can't listen to music because you're so reliant on it being up there, because the system says, don't worry, you don't need it. We'll look after it for you. You won't have it anymore. All right, let me just go on here. Yeah, also, the charts really at the moment are meant for kids. Now, I don't know if you agree or disagree with me here. Please thumbs up if you do, if you're in the UK. But I'm finding now when I listen on the odd occasion to Radio 1, it all seems to be a slow, like depressing hip-hop vibe with very minimal production, very minimal time spent in making the track. And we are in a stage now where if I listen to the top 40, I'm actually, as a mobile DJ, even though a lot of us aren't even working now, thinking I can't find myself playing any of these tracks because are people going to even know them? You know, maybe one or two that are like, yeah, they're very catchy. I understand that. I can see the dance floor dancing to that track. But also, if we take the charts today, how many of the tracks in the top 40 today can you physically see us as DJs playing in 2 or 3 years' time and the crowd going nuts? I can't see many at all, to be quite honest. Look at license agreements in software. Nobody owns any software, but you borrow the rights to use it, which can be revoked whenever they feel like it. Yes, Space Monkey Dave. Again, who looks at terms and conditions? Terms and conditions, tick the box. Thank you. Off you go. Very few of us do. Very few. John Bentley. Oh, yeah. Going into record shop, chatting with the staff, checking out the labels. Happy days. Versacara. Pirate radio will make its return out of necessity. Just got to keep the culture alive. Software defined radio has a bubble community. It does. But again, the charts really are, when I say for the youngsters, you know, I mean, you're looking sort of from, you know, 10-year-old up to about, you know, the teens. After that, hopefully people have got more insight into looking at real music and thinking, hold on a minute, there is more to life than the top 40. And believe me, there is. The top 40 is like a small little pond in your back garden compared to the Pacific and Atlantic Ocean out there where the real music is. Okay. Burn all your songs to disc if you can, ASAP, just in case. Yeah, again, Awakened Anon. I agree. You need to make sure you have hard copies of your music. Back your music up. Even if it's you buy a separate hard drive, you put all of it on the hard drive, you don't touch it, or you burn physical CDs. You know, because don't get into this thought of online and streaming. Because if the internet stops, what are you going to do? You can't do anything, can you? Point was making, though, it's okay. Space Monkey, point I was making, though, is if I work as a game dev, I work in a studio with 1,000 or so people, and we all work together to code the game and get salaried for it from a company, okay? Martin Depp, nice Tabosh hat, yeah. It's a fez. That's how we call it here in Lebanon. Tabosh, thank you. I do you know what? I love this hat, man. Simone G, visiting record shops was also a socializing thing. Yes, exactly. Community, meeting fellow DJs, you know, trying to get that white label before someone else did, trying to get that hot tune before the next DJ did, searching for that track that you've been looking for ages, putting the needle on the record and going, wow, taking it home, being so proud of playing that song that no one else has got, or very few. Nowadays, download the bugger. Space Monkey, in the music biz, it's one person versus the companies. The difference is that the music industry treats the artists as outsiders and not as staff. Yeah, again, the artists from music industry, the analogy is very simple. It's a farmer and the animals. The animals are there to make the farmer money. Once the animal gets too old, get rid of the bastard because there'll always be new ones. It's just economics. That's it. End of. In the music biz, one person versus Awakened Anon, spent half my life in record shops in Manchester. Good for you. Multi-depth, well, that's the commercial movement now. Shadow tunes to shadow people, youth and upcoming generation. Martin Lowry, I remember me crawling on dirty floors looking for a gem, which I usually found. Exactly, yes. You know, there's a record shop in Aberystwyth, Andy's Records. The guy still sells vinyl. I still on the odd occasion go in there, go and say hello, but he's a good guy. He has stuck to his guns, all right? He is still a physical music shop. Amazing. Okay. The Budgie 29, only play a chart track if it is asked for. Other than that, it's 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s. All on video. Okay, the Budgie 29, I'm exactly the same as you. Exactly. I will only play the track if someone asks for it. Otherwise, I will play tracks that people like, enjoy, and that have stood the test of time. In fact, I would find it highly unlikely in 10, 20 years' time, people will be begging me to play track number 20 or 30 in the charts today in 20 years' time. If I did play it in 20 years' time, if I'm still alive, I'd probably have things thrown at me. Let's have a look. Live Mix Radio 121. I used to buy loads of vinyl back in the 90s, HMV or Tempest Records, Birmingham. Now, get all my music downloaded free on any genre. Seriously, I have a huge CD collection from best of 50s, 60s, 70s and 80s. Right, Live Mix 121, don't get rid of it, keep it. Most people got rid of the CD collection or got rid of the vinyl, got CD, then got rid of the CDs and got downloads, you know? So you're slowly whittling away what you used to have physically to now having something that is nothing. Because when you, you know, oh, here's my collection of music. That's nothing, all right? That's music. These are, you know, all right, these are physical, okay? And all right, nothing lasts forever, but at least I have the physical copy, all right? So long as I look after those, that could all of a sudden collapse. Okay. John Bentley, Watch Human Traffic, the DJ Shop, Jungle Scene. Oh, yeah, love that tune. Awakened, Anon, Record Shop, White Label, 3 copies only. Yes, again, that's what we used to do as DJs. We used to bomb down into the record shop on a Monday and hope that we were one of the first people to get the white label when there was only 1 or 2 copies of it. Because the white label, you know, you knew if there was 2 copies and you got one of them, one of the DJ would get it. That meant 2 DJs have got it out of 30 or 40. You were one of the lucky ones. Live Radio 121, right. So in fact, my whole CD collection is on a 2 terabyte hard drive as a backup. You got to these days. I agree. Get a backup of a backup, okay? And if you've got a vinyl collection and you're thinking of selling it, don't. Keep it. Because that, in the future, possibly could buy you a house. Because we will very likely get to the stage where a good vinyl collection could almost be worth its weight in gold. All right, maybe not in gold, but it's going to be worth a shitload of money. It's like vinyl in the future will be like art. It will be highly, highly collectible. All right, so look after it. Multi-depth, thankfully here in Lebanon, we still got 2 vinyl record shops, and mostly I ship my records from abroad as electronic dance music isn't much available here on records. Good for you. Live Mix Radio, as well as latest charts, chucked to USB. So what I did, I've on vinyl, I still got round to putting it onto hard drive. USB happy days. Evening, Mr. Ellerskins. Ah, good for you. Space Monkey Dave, one thing COVID has sort of done, which I was doing with a DJ brand, me and my mate set up a live streaming. I always insisted on streaming our gigs for free. Now with, you know what, it's the norm. Yeah, well, it is. It's the norm. And again, listen, ladies and gentlemen, I don't normally ask, but in the description of this video is a link to PayPal, and it would be highly appreciated if you sent a small donation to myself here, because all of this content is for free. I do my best to make sure I give good quality content, and I'm a bit of a crazy guy. I don't know everything, but it's nice on the odd occasion to show your appreciation. So thank you very much. All right, so let me just go back, and don't forget as well to like and share this video. All right, okay, let's have a look. OCC. Okay, physical sales downloads. Yeah, so the OCC now, which now compile the charts, they make note of physical sales, downloads, and streaming. So guess what most of it is? It's streaming. So every time someone watches a video, that's a click. So if you think about it, all you've got to do is have the company watch that video 1 million times, and that in itself is going to boost up that track. Now also, the bubble of the top 40 is insane. You know, I could, even though I can't say now, but I am sure if you went and looked at the top 40 today and the artists in the top 40, they would be practically the same as last month and the month before and next month and the month after. Now also, Radio 1, I don't know whether they still do this, but at the beginning of each year, they used to say, we predict chart entries for this track, and we predict this artist is going to do well next year. Well, by definition, the tracks will do well and the artist will do well because they are in a position to play the track as much as they want. In turn, you listen to it, you buy it, and promote the artist so much that you end up liking the artist and buying it. So it's actually, it's a win-win for them. So they could all of a sudden say, we predict big things for Joe Bloggs down number 21 Sod Street, who can't sing to save his life. But if you get the right promotion, the right publicity, make him look good, and use auto changer for his voice, the guy will be in the charts. It's madness. One thing, okay, so Space Monkey makes me think if gigs are going to have an online element to them in future, you've got all these people in the club and all of the other people tuned in. Very possible. This is going to be another subject where gigs may go. We've heard recently that Glastonbury isn't happening this year, and I predict probably a load of other festivals will not happen. I've around 1,500 vinyl records and it's going nowhere, much to my wife's despair. Chris Foster, good for you. Keep them, even if they go under the bed. They're not going to do anything. One thing, and I have to do this myself with your vinyl, don't stack them like that. And guess what I'm doing over there? Yeah, all right. But most of them, you need to stack them like that. Because if you stack them like that, they can warp. Like that, they should be fine. All right, so just a quickie there. The Budgie 29, our town would close on a Wednesday afternoon, and Mark, one half of Alton, would come in and all the DJs would get in and listen to the new tracks and he would take orders. Great days. Yep. Does anyone here, maybe watching now or in the future, remember Summit Records in Birmingham in the Bullring? There was actually two Summit Records. There was one in the Bullring and there was a smaller one opposite from the exit out of the station. What a vibe, what energy. In the one in the Bullring in Birmingham, there were two rooms. There was one, I think, remember, played like reggae and stuff like that and dub. The other one was like house and soul. And I remember back in the day, you know, big counter, and you just say, all right, can I listen to that? And the DJ would play the music, massive sound system in there, really loud. Ah, it was just an insane time. It was energy and vibe. So again, the human trafficking film, you know, with the DJ playing the drum and bass, that's exactly what it was like. It was just amazing. Summit, Reading Tones, Summit, yeah, Summit. It was Summit Records in Birmingham. I've still got some of the tracks from there, you know. They were amazing times. Loved it. Mark Guzman, John, how can we help you get a better video and audio signal? Your content is always good information. It would be nice for us to have top quality audio video. Just ask. Okay. Right. I've got a good camera. I just need to get the settings right. That's all. So that's all it is. In half an hour, that old rec shop, live mix radio, in half an hour from that old record shop. Okay, you were half an hour from there. Yeah. I mean, Summit Records, it was an experience. But anyway, I'm going to finish off now with basically saying that I personally feel that the top 40 is completely manufactured. The artists in the top 40 are completely manufactured. How the top 40 is made is completely manufactured. They know what's going to be in the top 40. And the big companies who run the music industry will carry on running their cartel for as long as they can to make sure they get the lion's share of the revenue. And they will not let anyone else in. Only when they want. So as soon as an artist has got enough money, they've reached a certain age, and the sound changes, they'll bring someone else in. Okay, that's the way it works. And sure enough, the teeny boppers will start following someone else. You've only got to look at old films and the posters on people's walls from the 70s to the 80s to the 90s to the noughties 2000s. You very rarely have the same posters on all of the walls. They're always going to be different. What's that hat on you, George Mora? It's a fez. This is a fez. I am a son of the desert. Now, that's another fine mess you've gotten me into. Bluebird Records by day, Gaming Palace by night. A Turkish one, that's it. Any charts these days are manipulated. Tom, they are. Okay, right. Listen, that's it for me. It's been 50 minutes. Thank you for watching. Again, ladies and gentlemen, in the description of this video is a link to PayPal where you can give me a donation. Even if it's a dollar, a pound, it will be greatly appreciated. Everyone who sends a donation, I always email them and say thank you. Simply because my content is for free, okay? And that's it. And I hope you've enjoyed this stream. I will be doing more streams. But, you know, again, thank you very much for watching. Budgie29, thank you. Richard Vogue, thank you very much. But all I'm asking you guys, okay, what I want you to do is if you do always watch the charts and listen to them, and I'm pretty convinced that most of you will be doing this anyway, but there is a vast array of music out there, artists, producers, DJs, far superior to the ones in the mainstream. And there are some bedroom DJs out there who could wipe the ass off some of these big superstar DJs. They're completely better. But again, the superstar DJ industry is exactly the same as the music industry. It's a club. It's a cartel. It's difficult to get in there, but once you're in there, you're set up. All right? Thank you very much for watching. Don't forget to like and share, send a donation, practice and enjoy. God bless. Thank you. Thank you, guys.